Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the first technical presentation of our very beginning section of the 2015-2016. The topic today, role of silicon in sustainable construction. We talk of sustainable, everything is sustainable. Sustainable construction, green concept, these are the concepts coming into the industry nowadays. When I get to the speaker's profile, I think it's a best reason to speak from this particular topic. Mr. Ambedkar is his second name, Saha. Basab Saha has been a very senior personality in the Dow Corning company. He is doing a lot of research in addition to his duties. Rather than me going through the profile, you can see the profile. I straight away call upon Mr. Saha to start.
Thank you all. Thanks to all of you for taking out of your time, out of your busy schedule, especially in the evening, website outside, it's monsoon outside, and take out your time and be here to listen to me. And it has been my honor to come and present in front of you about silicons, the technology of silicons, and what silicons can contribute to the construction industry as a fraternity. And what silicons can contribute in terms of durability, sustainability, green, low VOC, you know, those type of things. So let me introduce myself. As you said, Basab, my first name, Saha is my second name. And it's good to get connected with the engineering fraternity. That's again a pride for me after passing out from the engineering college some 30 years ago, close to 30 years now. It's getting connected with to the fraternity, so that's again a pride moment for me to get and stand in the podium and talk about something new to the technological advancement. As we draw the S-curve, people have gone through a lot of understanding about elastomeric components. One is the B2B Marketing from mastic compound, then a lot of polysulfide, a lot of polyurethane, then the next generation is the inorganic technology, where the silicons play a bigger role. So with that, I would just like to highlight a brief about the company. As a company, it's a basically a Midland, Michigan based US company, which is a joint venture company between Dow Chemical Corporation and Corning Incorporated, established in the year 1943. These two companies, what they did is, they came along together with two different ideas and concepts, and they tried to explore the potential of silicon, what silicon can do. And those explorations helped in developing the products and technologies into a new innovative solution called silicones, S-I-N-C-O-N and C-O-N-E. So that development has changed the, changed the human technology, human life, and the basic needs of customers across the globe. And that's a typical development which has done, and believe me, when we move forward, let me give you some few examples what silicon play a bigger role. Silicon in the first product when it was developed, it was used as an ignition sealing compound in aircrafts. So when we talk about that, and these all are associated with engineering fraternity. So these aircrafts were sealed with ignition sealing compound with silicon material, and that helped the flights to take the higher altitudes where the temperature is at minus zone. So that is one initial development was brought in. Then silicon as a compound was the first to use as a release tapes, releasing material. So that has helped, you know, the labeling industries, the packaging industries to use the tapes as a self-adhesive tapes, which is again the release compound. Silicon played a major role in development of those activities. That's again a new challenge and development happened. Silicon as a product, again, when the technology was developed, was again used as an adhesive in the structural glazing system in the building facade. So what you see, a lot of new buildings coming up with glass and with the glass and the subframe. So that's again a technological advancement, that glass and the bonding of the material with the subframe, that aluminium. The adhesive brought a lot of challenges and satisfaction to the engineering fraternity, especially the architects and consultants, to develop new ways of doing some building facades. That's again an area of development. people are using a lot of telephones, mobiles, the tablets and all. You know, every electronic components are having a thin film coating, which is called a conformal coatings. And you can use the touch screen base and all. So those all small thin coatings are of silicone basically. So people across the electronic industries and people are using a lot of silicones into those applications, which is not visible, but certainly there are silicones into that. Lot of ladies are using lot of cosmetics, beauty care products, skin care products. Now that has changed the facet of the healthcare industry, the pharmaceutical industry, because you use moisturizers, you use lot of shampoos and all. Everything has got silicones into that. Again, for the men, the wrinkle-free pants and the shirts and cotton, 100% cotton, those comes with silicone. So that's a change the facet of the textile industry. The textile industries are using large amount of silicones into that. So silicones as an innovative product has developed a lot of solutions for different applications, and that has changed. So that's one our contribution to the global area, what silicones can do. So that has been our activity of silicones. Now going forward, let me tell you what exactly Dow Corning as a corporation do, where are we and how do we contribute to your country market on the basis of this presentation slide. Now silicon, how does it form silicon basically? Now you know the earth crust is made of silica as a sand. Now when silica as a sand, which is available in abundance in the material on the earth crust. So basically there are two chemicals in this, one is silica and one is oxygen. So that is the molecules which contribute to the silicon oxygen bond, and from silica as the earth it processed. And that is the first stage of the formation of silica, is the silicon metal. So what you see here is the silicon metal. So this silicon metal is formed from the process of the silica and contributed in the form of oxygen is introduced, and that silicon metal. This metal now is polymerized, and then polymerization helps in forming of a silicon polymer as a linear. This is the first step of linear polymerization of silicon metal, which is made out of silica earth, and that's a long process which has been put up into two small photographs. And that is where silicon starts the developmental activity, from the linear polymer to our chemical formulations of polymerization to different inclusions of different organic components, and then a silicon oxygen bond molecule polymerized form is made. And that's the silicon polymer. Now let me share with you some magical moments of this silicon polymer, what has changed the world. And that might give you much more interesting facts about what the silicon can do. As I said, the first ignition counseling compound, BC4, was one program. So that has helped over here. Everybody knows in 1969, the first man to land on moon or the lunar space was Neil Armstrong. How did he land? His rubber sole, the boot, the rubber sole of the boot was made of silicon rubber. So that helped him to walk on the space with the use of silicon as a rubber. So that helps the industry a lot in those developments in the technical space, in the lunar space. Everybody drives cars, and a lot of equipment, electronics are nowadays being used in car, automobile, in automotive industries. You know, on an average, each car contains around 8 kilograms of silicon as an electronic, for to cover the as an insulative property for the electronic components in the car. So that's again a big industry which has changed the automotive industry to use a lot of electronics in the car, automotive car. That's again a change. Textile, as I said, it's again a lot of active ingredients have been used in terms of dispersion of textile yarns into a lot of wearing products. So that's again a changing world. For us as an engineering fraternity from the construction world, the tallest structure you know is the Burj Khalifa as of now. Of course, more than that, taller structures are coming up in Taiwan and all. But here, 200 tons of silicon were used for structural glazing facade in Burj Khalifa building. So that's again a changing facade, changing world, and the technological advancement of people moving of sustainable, durable constructions, of using inorganic components as part of the product development and building material solutions in the construction industry also. So when I say of silicon, so what Dow Corning does is try to understand the customer needs. We try to give the solution for each customer needs, and we talk of major industries across the world. And talk of the industries, talk of the needs, and we try to give solutions for across the industries what silicon can provide that need-based solution. So going forward, silicon as a product, as a solution, has made changes or are going to make changes for their livelihood, and that has not only helped the human being, only the industries, that has also helped the human mankind of billions of people across the globe. So that's the advantage of silicon across the industry, where it plays a bigger role, and not only for construction, there are other industries also. So to cut short, just to explain you what the silicon does and how it is formed. Silicon metal, as I said, is processed, and then the main two components are methanol. So that is the biggest component of transforming silicon metal into chlorosilanes. And the chlorosilanes is one first form of the formation of the polymer, and there it is changed into linear, and that is the where you see first stage is coming as here, the silicon polymer, the siloxane. Through there, it is a polymerization, and through polymerization, depending upon the application, depending upon the needs of the customer, depending upon the industry application, what happens? It comes in different forms. Silicons, if you have seen, there are few displays available as a gel form, cured form on the table. As the time frees up, you can go and see the sample. But silicon in its primary form is a liquid, but it can get changed with the infusion of organic components. One attachment of either ethyl, methyl, or different aminos. So those are the organic components which are attached and can change it into fluids, powders, emulsions, gels, resins. You know, that's the advantage of silicon in different forms. So it's not only in one form it comes in multiple forms. And those dispersions available can be used for any of the industries you talk about, including the construction. Even in constructions also, we use in different forms. You must have come across sealants as a product, which is normally a gel type. But there are powders, there are emulsions, which can be used as an admixture, an additive, and can benefit the industry in terms of water repellency, hydrophobization, and some mechanical properties gained in terms of compressive strength on water reduction also. So those are the technical challenges where we as a designer, as a consultant, as an engineer, can work upon in a collaborative way and try to find a solution and the best design practice we can incorporate in the mind of the fraternity. So what happens, what gives the silicon basically? It is used as basically a good wetting and spreading compound. So when I talked of pharmaceutical or healthcare industry for the shampoos and all, you know, it allows the material to disperse, to spread out. So that's where silicon plays a very bigger role. It is a long-term elastic material with better durability, better UV resistant properties, better weatherability. When I talk of weatherability, means I have called upon the high altitude applications in the aircraft, minus 50, minus 60 degrees. At Burj Khalifa, plus 50 degrees. So, you know, it's a versatile product as an inorganic chemistry. It can work in a service type temperature of minus 50 to plus 200 under normal conditions without any special application needs. But in case of special application needs like plus 650 or high temperature sealants you require in terms of silicon, that also can be used and applied in high temperature zones also up to plus 1000 degrees centigrade. So that is a benefit of using silicon in the industry application. Then it's a stable, it's an inert basically, and it's a water repellent material, and it has got lot of good mechanical properties. And when you go in a isolated way in terms of property of why you select the product. So that's the benefit of silicon, why silicon is gaining momentum in and acceptance in the construction industry for lot of applications, including admixture applications, because of certain due respect to the properties. Of course, it's not 100% that being an engineer, being a marketing person, I don't want to say that my product or this silicon is the best. Silicon has got limitations. Certainly, with all those limitations also, we can develop some innovative solutions in the industry. And that's the basic advantage of silicon moving forward. Now, as sir told about sustainability, yes, we are, our duty is also to move towards sustainable solutions and a durable solution. So, as we know that buildings normally contribute almost 40% of the carbon emissions due to the loadings coming through the lighting, cement being used, cement has got lot of carbon dioxide emissions when the cement is used. So, we also contribute to that. And as in professionals, how do we mitigate those emissions into a sustainable construction? And no single product can give you zero VOC or a 100% sustainable green product. So it's a mix of products, mix of application, mix of lot of things, and does contribute to that. So in that case, silicons also play a bigger role in contributing as a one contributor to the net zero effect of the building. So we also claim that it's a contributor, and how do we go into the net zero effect into the building. So that is again a part of our sustainable contribution as a CSR, corporate social responsibility. We do ensure that we are also into that game plan of sustainable construction, durable construction, and try to help the industry of certification of the building through some green building certification. So that's the silicon basically. Now, if I am fast, stop me. If you would like to raise questions, stop me. Please make it interactive, because I have not come here to give you a speech. It's a technical session, and if you want to stop me to have more clarity on the subject, it will be my pleasure to give you more clarifications as we move around. Okay. So when we talk of this silicon, basically from Dow Corning perspective, from my perspective, we are catering to different markets, from the facade, the building materials, the interior solutions, there are horizontal ceiling compounds, and there is infrastructure. So this is the basic market categorization when we talk of construction activities, and the construction has been divided into different markets. And talk about the market, silicon can play a bigger role into those markets providing a sustainable solution. And that's when we talk of the market, what are the different applications could be? It could be a smart glazing, it could be a lighting, it could be a curtain wall, it could be structural glazing, it could be window solutions, it could be facade protection, dry mix, architectural coating. So these are different applications, whatever you think at the first sight. And those all areas of application in these different markets can help, silicon can help in providing a durable construction, a sustainable, a green solution, and your whole needs of your requirement can be fulfilled through this work. So that's where we play a role, and through this solution of different applications. Now, how do we come to this solution basically? As a contributor to the net zero building, what we do is we try to analyze the market for the future. And what we try to, how do we analyze that this market through the mega trends? So what we do then, when we study the market, when we study the mega trends, what we identify are that there are four key mega trends in the, for the near future, in the next 20 to 25 years time frame. These are the four changing facets of the world. One is energy. Everybody is talking about energy. How do we conserve energy? How do we save energy? And what buildings can do in saving energy? I think that's a big platform and challenge for all of us as an engineer, that how we can contribute to the net zero effect, saving and conserving energy, and having the building with a better building management systems. And that's where we also contribute. Now, how do we do that building management system contribution? It's not only the building construction, the RCC framework of the building, or brick walls, or some lightweight modular weight building materials being used, or better windows. But building as a system, it's other than that, the main contributor is the HVAC system, the air conditioning system, the lighting system, there are water management systems, So it's all a mix of a lot of active components of a building, which makes a contribution to the energy management system of the building. So that's again one changing mega trend across the world, and this country is also going through a lot of changes in terms of this type of product solution. And of course, our role plays a bigger role as a contributor to this energy management system. Now, when we talk of one component, another component is the building materials. Now, a lot of building materials are used in the construction of the building. We talk of aluminium subframe or aluminium windows, because all have got embodied energy, which normally transfers the energy from a lower medium to higher medium, and those type of transfers of heat waves happens. So can we look for some saving in those aspects of recycled materials, aggregates and all, because a lot of activities are going in the engineering studies also, that how to use recycled aggregates in the making of the better construction, better durable construction. So there also silicon play a bigger role, you know, because when you use the recycled aggregate, the porosity, those are very porous materials. They have a lot of water. Silicon can use in reduction of those porosities through technical advancement, and silicon can play a durable role in those type of building material components. Then the mega trend is the indoor air quality, better air quality improvements you are trying to do. Sealing of the buildings properly so that there is no escape of the air from outside and inside, of a low temperature to high temperature to low temperature. So those are the better indoor air quality. Then safety hazards, fire, lot of tall structures are coming up, lot of fire. I think across the globe you are getting news of fire happening in such this building, that building. So engineers are getting aware about how to better give a solution about fire protection system in the building. So how do you do that? The most disturbing thing when a fire happens in the building is smoke transferring from one floor to the other floor or one room to the other floor. So when we design a building, we need to ensure that we need to properly seal the gaps so that the smoke during the fire hazard doesn't transfer. And that is the biggest concern of any fire hazard, that smoke is a more disturbing element for human life. So that's again a solution we try to give with the silicon. The silicon can help in a better smoke seal solution. Then as I said, one component is the water, so water management. So these are the changing mega trends, and while we study the mega trends changing, so what happens, Dow Corning plays a bigger role because our passion to drive is to innovation. So it's not only a product, we give a solution for an existing material, but we continuously innovate, and we are almost $6.2 billion global company, and we invest 5% of our turnover in doing the innovative development, and where the R&D is continuously doing some developmental activities, and we put back all our footfalls into the innovative solution. So these are some of the innovative solutions you can see across this mega trend chart that we are continuously developing. Some of the developments are already done, some are already in progress, and we are trying to be a part of that global scenarios of sustainable construction. So that's where this is how we innovate, and based on the mega trend, and that's our technical challenges we do. So as we move forward, so I will conclude on my presentation in three segments. One is the facade, is the first. One is the construction chemical, and one is the innovations what we do. So going forward, hopefully, if there are any questions, do let me know, or then I can move into the next segment. Okay. Now, when we move into facade, basically, facades are not linear structures. The most difficult challenge comes to the engineers when they are representing a consulting firm or an architectural firm. The facade is not being a linear, and aesthetically they want to design it. The difficult challenges come when it becomes a curve or some trapezoidal or sloping section, because glass, when put it into the different shapes and forms, that comes the challenging moment for any architectural consultant to design the structure into different shapes. And there, how do we do that is a technical challenge. And there, the designer's role plays a bigger role. And from the silicon side, silicon being a versatile material, as I said, becomes the first choice of most of the engineers to use silicon as an adhesive into this facade system. And as we design this system also, what happens, there are different systems. Now one is doing at site, we call it a stick system. In this stick system, there are mullions and transverse coming directly, there are glass, and these are being tested at site with the silicon adhesive. So that's one system of glazing being done at site. But this is not the one system which can be done at site, because at site there are construction challenges, the application challenges, and lot of time quality control cannot be done at site the way you desire by an applicator. So that is again a question for a lot of the professionals, how to do a better system. So when you talk about better system, there are other systems. This is called the unitary system or the structural glazing system. This is the type of system being done. This is one subframe, and this is the frame, main frame, and this is the glass. So what happens? This frame and this glass, these are done at the factory under a controlled environment, under a controlled areas where quality control can be done to the 100% satisfaction. And there, these materials are getting transported to site and then executed and erected at the building to the subframe. So you have the subframe at site, you have this frame, main frame, and this frame at the factory, and those are getting installed. So you are 100% confident that this can be done at a very good quality control area. So those are the areas. When you design a structure, you should always specify that the glazing system has to be done at a factory under ambient condition, under a controlled environment, to do a better durable construction. That is again a good engineering practice. And this is again another form of unitary system which can help into again a factory based system and a different way of doing the work. So that's the two different ways of doing it. And what is our strength is, we pioneer into the structural glazing system and we try to be. So what's the benefit of this facade when you design? It gives you better aesthetics. Because of the normal building materials, if you use and do the plaster, do the painting, at the end of the day, when you see from far off, you see a lot of elevational problems and issues that can be seen after the building painting is done. But when it's a glass facade system, the building looks very attractive. And it's the changing face of the world, and people are using lot of glasses into the building, especially when the orientation is proper and the buildings can perform better. Apart from that, it can do a facelifting renovations also. When the buildings are old, people do put the glass and say, and there silicon play a better role and do the facelifting as a renovation. It can help you in better sealing of the building, silicon as a part. It can give you a better indoor air quality move, better lighting control, better health environment, and silicon as a product can give you a better limitless design and a design freedom to all of the fraternity. So that's where it gives a better benefit in terms of installation, and it can also increase the productivity and cost benefit at the end of it. Because as an engineer, again, when we talk about anything application, we always talk about the cost, and certainly when you get a comparative evaluation, the cost benefit is one of the returns we need to calculate, and what is the best returns on investment. And certainly when you do this type of analysis in terms of life cycle expectancies of any building for a sustainable construction, silicon plays a very bigger role into that. I have hidden some of the data over here because of the requirements by the association, but certainly what I wanted to show here is, it's not only a building of 10-story, 14-story. When we talk of building of 100-story, 200-story buildings coming up, I think here in Sri Lanka, the maximum story is 66-story is coming up right now. We have buildings in India, which is in Mumbai, is coming up 100-story residential tower is coming up. So buildings are growing taller. Now, when the buildings grow taller, what happens? The technological challenges is design. Firstly, the architects find difficult what should be the facade system in terms of aesthetics, and they want always a very linear, smaller, thinner sections and structures so that maximum aesthetic look can be retained in the building. But in terms for the consultants and the engineer designers, what challenges they face as they go building floor taller? Lot of wind load variations happen. In that also a lot of wind pressure comes in. And this mushrooming of lot of tall structures, again, these areas of low wind zone areas also, lot of wind tunnel pressures come within the building system. So that again creates lot of high wind pressure areas. So normally we have seen the wind pressure going up to 7 kPa, 8 kPa in certain areas. Of course, these tall structures are also being built in the land of Philippines, where every day you see typhoons or hurricanes are coming. In Taiwan, hurricanes, typhoons are coming. Now, does it restrict the designers to design a building because of the wind pressure? No. Does it restrict the designers to use not a glazing system and use a conventional building material? No. So, where they can continuously design the best of the materials being used available and to design it in the system. But now, we as a designer, we have to come up with a probable solution. Here, with the high wind load areas also, we as a Dow Corning, we have got our own design team. We collaborate with the designers from the consultant side, and we help designing these tall structures for a high wind load zone areas also. So there are zones where high wind loads are available. So we use normal, we don't use the conventional design theory. We use either a finite element analysis method or a trapezoidal joint design method, where we can help the designer to do the design calculation using a slender sections of aluminium, not to enlarge the sections at the higher elevations, with a slimmer bite size calculations of silicones, so where you can be comfortable to use a smaller section, reduce the overall cost of the building envelope, and we also help you in doing some testing, wind tunnel testing of designing the building. So it's a collaborative effort in designing, but silicon happened to be one of the solutions for most of the designers in using those collaborative solutions, and we certainly help you in this kind of design. So that's the technical challenges. Wherever we overcome, it's an approach and we try to give a solution. So these are the different locations where different areas you can see across the globe where wind load up to 7 kPa also has been designed, and those are withstanding right for few years, and there is no, till now there is no calamity or there are no challenges for us coming in terms of silicon solutions. So when I say of silicon being used, now we have done the first building of structural glazing system using silicon as an adhesive in 1971 at Detroit, and building is still performing without any changes in the behavior of the silicon pattern, and there are few more hundreds of buildings have been done across the globe, across different climatic conditions, right from Antarctica to the maximum in the Dubai, Middle East areas, where the high temperature zone is available. So it plays a very versatile role in different climatic conditions, and that proves the efficacy of using silicon as an inorganic technology in construction industry. And it is not only, as I said, a limitless design. When we talk of the limitless design, you know, the other advantage is what you see is it can also take care, as a silicon as an inorganic, it can also take care of fire hazards. It can also take care of the seismic loads. It can take care of the normal wind loads. It can take care of the water repellency or the waterproofing mechanism in the buildings. So these are the different areas where it can perform in a different, rather than only bonding, it can have different multiple benefits out of using silicon into the different construction industry. So that's the technical advancement using an inorganic technology and silicon, and that's play a bigger role. So when you design a structure with a probable solution using a silicon, I think that can give you a much more comfort in design and the service life, enhancing the service life of the building. So that's the advantage of the building system. So as we said, that silicon, it not only retains the aesthetics of the building, it is going to be give you an energy efficient building mechanism in terms of the building design or the building management system. It can give you protective glazing effort, and it gives you long-term durability of solution. Of course, nothing is possible unless you do a proper quality management system. So we also help our designers, our consultants, our architects, our end customers in collaborating for a monitoring of the throughout the process of with a proper quality management service under the name quality bond. If you happen to type quality bond Dow Corning, you will get lot of reading materials available in the Google. You can take your own time to read what this quality bond. It's a quality management system from Dow Corning to help the fraternity to adhere to the best construction practices, best engineering practices, and attain the durable needs of the end customer, so that customer can get comfort when you hand over the building for that normal life cycle usage. Of course, we are a global company, we are globally present, and we give the comprehensive engineering services, also system design completely through our facade engineering and architectural team. We have a teams located in Europe and USA. So our engineering teams can help with your team to collaborate and give you sustainable solutions. So that's one part of the segment, facade. Any questions, any conclusion, clarity, or more detailing you require? That's the reason what Dow Corning has is beyond our strength. We have got 7,000 plus products in our range and with different chemistries. Because silicon as a product, as I said, it's a inorganic chemistry. But if you go refine the chemistries, we have got different chemistry. We have our sealants basically. It comes in either an acidic pure sealant, which is acetoxy, which has neutral pure sealants. Neutral cure chemistry comes in different forms. One is an oxygen technology, which is a ketone based, and one is an alcohol based, that is an alkoxy sealant. So we have a different chemistry of sealant to meet the purpose of different areas, different requirements. And that the chemistry differentiates the technology and the end application. So we have got different solutions for different locations, and that's how we differentiate out.
Is it toxic?
It's not toxic. Once it's cured, it's in top. It's absolutely normal. So moving ahead in terms of silicones in different forms. One form we saw as a sealant, as an adhesive in gel form. Now we talk of the liquid form or an emulsion form. Historically, you have seen silicone, or you have heard the word very typical generic name is water repellent. So water repellent is basically are the silicone form, which are basically a penetrant or the film former or the impregnation materials. So what happens that silicon in its historical form is a post-treatment water repellent. Basically, you put it on the building materials, brick or concrete or any cementitious materials, and all the seals get blocked by the silicon material as a sealant, and it give you a water repellent effect. That is a some sort of bubble effect, and you know the lotus effect, we call it a beading effect. So that's how silicon is known for the water repellent effect. But as we are moving forward in the next generation, we are also developing solutions as an admixture, because silicon has never been used as an admixture into the cementitious chemistry, and people do have lot of hesitations in understanding how come silicon can be a part of that, because we have understood lot of organic materials like lignosulfonates, like melamine based or SNF, and those are being normally used as an admixture material. But silicon as a next gen, we have developed technologies which can be used as an admixture in different silicon cementitious materials. So I'll just give you briefing on that products also. So what happens basically? Why the silicon as a water repellent material required? Now we have been using cement for years. And cement is by the nature, it's an exothermic material, everybody knows. So it has got a very high surface energy material, it's a high surface energy material when it is used in our construction material basically. Now, on the other hand, we use water. For cement hydration, we require water. Now, water has got a high surface energy. Now, both when coming together, when with a surface high energy and a high surface tension material, it allows the cementitious material substrates to get ready. Now, when both the high surface energy and high surface tension wear comes together, the surface wets, and cement by its inherent property, it has got some sort of shrinkage cracks always within the system. So, and those shrinkage cracks get interconnected when the pores are getting connected. So, it allows the water to penetrate inside, and through capillary action, the surface transports from the lower medium to higher medium. And that's the problem of the cementation, which normally is a problem for a lot of areas in cementation, in the engineering fraternity. And that really requires some sort of protection in there. So, silicons in that case, as a water treatment or as a post-treatment solution in those type of locations, can be coated with the silicon treatment, and the sealed for initial substrate pores get sealed, because those are the sealers or impregnators, and that blocks the pores. So that as the first step, when water coming from the outside, it doesn't allow the water to get entered into the cementitious medium, and that is one area. So in this historical that has been used. The advantage is you get as a hydrophobic material or water repellent substrate, and you do not lose any mechanical properties. But as a next gen product, what we have developed is the admixture, which is normally a water repellent admixture, basically can be used while making the mortar or concrete, and that can be used in the cement aqueous form. And that helps in blocking the pores internally, cutting all the interconnected blocks of the pores, and cut the capillary actions of the cementitious block medium. So that's the advantage of using as an admixture. But a bit of limitations into this, that you have to design the materials in a certain in a way that the proportioning of the cement, sand, aggregate, and the admixture has to be in a way that it doesn't impact the mechanical properties of the total concrete medium or the mortar medium. So that's, we need to design the substrate, and we have to be active in designing the substrate when we use silicon as an admixture into the substrate. So there designers play a bigger role how we can achieve that in optimizing the dosage of the application and catering to the end needs of the market or the properties of the concrete. So that as an admixture we can do. So what happens when? How does it actually behave? Because I thought that I should put this slide for you to understand what exactly happens when we talk of admixture. Because when silica as a material or cement as a material, it is a basically lime. And when water comes in contact, it forms calcium hydroxide. And that's the first stage of the hydration process. When the process of hydration continues, there are secondary reactions happening within the cementitious matrix. You have got free lime, and you have got the first complex reaction called the silicate hydrates. These silicate hydrates, comes in the form of freelime, basically. So, silicon as the other end, they have got a silicon hydrogen molecule, oxygen molecule. So, that gets attached with the silicate hydrates and the silicon oxygen bond molecule. That forms a chemical reaction, and those molecules, the reaction helps in cutting the capillaries within the system with the formation of a hydroxyl group or then umbrella formation. So that hydroxyl group formation makes an umbrella on the substrate, and that helps in having a lower surface tension on the substrate, and that doesn't allow the water to impregnate or allow the water to go inside the material. So that's how the basic reactions of this. And that's where the silanol phase, both the silanol phase reacts, and that's. But what happens, the benefit of this system is, if at site, if somebody cuts the building materials or the bricks or which is being used, the entire material will be hydrophobic even if it is cut, which is not there in the post-treatment system. Post-treatment system, if you cut it, you damage the system. There is a breakage of the reactivity. But in the admixture system, you get a continuity of those silanol hydroxyl group formation, and you are absolutely tension-free that you need to break the materials and put the bricks or the blocks in the system, silicon will still be active in the system. So that's the benefit of it, even an admixture into the system. And that's the developmental work we have done in the next gen, and that's how the you say application as a post-treatment water repellent. What it could be used as a normal general purpose, it can be used as a natural on the natural concrete or a exposed concrete. It can be used in the salty structure, especially the marine structure where chloride and sulfate attacks are thrown, and silicon can play a bigger role in the marine structure. What helping the passivation of the steel. So when you help in the passivation of the steel, so it will delay the corrosion effect on the reinforcement and increase the durability of the structure. So there are special silicones which are in the neat form and which can be coated on the substrates and can help you in a durable marine structure also. So that's the benefit of the silicone to get out of it. And those are in the post-treatment solutions. Apart from that, when we talk of the admixture, silicon plays a very bigger role nowadays in versatile applications, fiber reinforced cement boards. People are increasingly using for the shelter, for the partition walls, for the exterior walls, in concrete admixtures, in dry mix mortars. People are using ready to use plasters nowadays. People are using skin coats nowadays for the wall application. People are using also a lot of hydrophobic materials within the system to make it hydrophobic plaster. So they don't have to do. Even for the architectural coatings also. For the normal paints, a lot of elastomeric coatings are coming up as a water repellent paints, with a water repellent elastomeric coating, where silicon plays a bigger role for the paint industry also. And for the normal building materials like nitrogen concrete. So these are the different applications where silicon plays a bigger role in terms of admixture in different building material industries. So that's, again, it's a part of the mega trend what I showed, that how do we increase the life cycle analysis of the building materials and reduce the embodied energy of the materials, because when silicons are used, what happens? It doesn't absorb water. And when water is not absorbed by these building materials, it is not reflecting high energy into the material. So, you know, in terms of efficiency of the buildings within the this, when there is no water absorption, it's not absorbing heat. So there is no heat transfer happening. So you're also reducing, you are helping the building to perform in the better building management system, in better energy efficient system. So that's where silicon can play a bigger role into an energy efficient embodied energy materials also. So this is how the second stage of the silicon in an emulsion form, in a fluid form, in a liquid form can help in building materials. That's again a challenge for to be met in the site. Any questions, any clarifications, please?
No.
Thank you. Okay, now going to this, these are for the professionals, for the interior application. Here it is not much, but you know, a lot of windows are being designed for building. Windows are coming in different forms, either windows made at site, windows made at factory. There are different ways of making windows. So there are people concerned, the resource constraints for many of the manufacturing companies making windows. They want to reduce the number of labors also at times. They want to mechanize the application process. So there are different ways of doing windows applications. The basic window form is the normal windows which come and be fitted at the building installation. So, but there are certainly some gaps in the window area, and those gaps allow the water or the air to pass through. So there we can use silicone to seal the system, and so that there is no water leakages, no air seepages happening through this. So this will improve the indoor air quality systems also, and the building will remain safe in terms of leakages and seepages. So there are ways of doing this. When you go for the mechanized system, the silicone comes in different forms, increasing the productivity, increasing the visible area of the glass, because if you see the window frames, there are sash, there are mullions, there are lot of frames. So you use frames, you use gaskets, you use lot of. So for using those you have to increase the size of the frames. So silicon comes in again a different form. It's a hot melt also is available as backbending technology. It can reduce the size of the frames. It can be a faster technological production in terms of productivity, and it can give you a better visible area. So silicon can be help can be used in the form of different applications. Silicon?
Yeah.
So, you are asking for the overhead application from here? Okay. The silicons basically are different, as I said that there are silicons, what basic material is a silicon, is one material in this. One is silicon, one is a catalyst. So there are different ways of reactions happening in the atmosphere. One is a silicon is built with a catalyst within. So one part system, wherever you see a silicon, one part system is available. So those are basically a moisture curing system. When I talk of moisture curing systems, the silicon as a basic material has got catalyst within it, and that catalyst gets reacted with the normal moisture, which is available in the normal humidity condition. And those catalyst and the moisture helps in activation of the catalyst, and that starts curing within the system. So what happens when you apply a sealant in any vertical application or on an overhead application, those are basically a non-sag material, so it will not fall down first. First 5 minutes, the skinning happens on the sealant. So you have a small thin layer of film forming in the next first 5 minutes, 5 to 7 minutes. So that is a skinning time. Then next 30-35 minutes, it's a tacky time. Tacky time is slightly thickening of the skin, and if you touch it, it will not come with your finger. So that is a tacky time. So the sealant has been designed in a way that when you apply a sealant in any form, it first form of skinning. In the skinning, so it is starting of the curing process starts. But if you touch it within the skinning time, you will get some sticky material on your finger. But since the applicator who is applying the sealant, he has certain application time. So I cannot allow him to make it a mechanized process. So we are given sufficient time, around 35-40 minutes, for tooling, for leveling, for other application work. So within 30-35 minutes, he can do any type of work. He can spread, he can tool, he can take care of. So after 35 minutes, if he tries to do any work, he can't do anything. So 1 mm, almost 0.5 mm, gets thickened, and that tacky time is happening now. Now beyond the tacky time, you can't do anything. You should not disturb the sealant. Now the history says, and the technical literature says, that sealant has a curing period of 1 mm per day. So which 1 mm thick cure, it takes almost 24 hours to cure. So once the sealant has formed a skinning and tack free, be rest assured the sealant is not going to go anywhere, and slowly the curing process starts within the system automatically. And we say that 7 days is the normal curing time for the sealant to get completely cured.
There is a condition to be the fully dry surface, and if we apply then the water is there. Between the window and the wall, but what should be the condition of the wall? It should be 100% dry, or can we apply it when it's better?
It should be completely dry. Completely dry. That is the most preferred way. But up to certain conditions, like 2-3% moisture, if it is still there, still it can be allowed. But it should not be completely dry, wet wall, and we apply. It should not happen. At least the surface condition should be relatively dry.
How many hours you need to protect it from the rain?
I said, first skinning and tack face 30 minutes. at least if you are protecting it for 1 hour time, so that's good enough. You know, the first skinning has happened, tacky has happened. So internal will be curing on its own from the outside moisture. At least the surface is not getting disturbed if rain happens within 1 to 2 hours. But we should try to protect it at least for 1 day, at least minimum. Otherwise, you know, the bonding may not happen because if the substrate gets wet on the sides completely, so it may have affect the bonding. So we need to have that bonding effect. So at least 1 day should be a good enough time to at least have a protection.
But is there a maximum depth
between the wall and the anything with the real time extent? We recommend that for a good application, 6 mm wide gap should be there. Minimum 6 mm. Maximum 2 years. It is, the more the gap you keep, more the silicons are used. So more the suppliers benefit. It's a marketing strategy there. Yes, it is. I will tell you what happens. Every sealant has got a movement of homogeneous pattern. Since sealants have elastomeric properties, sealants move with the thermal stresses. So every sealant has got movement capacities to move around. So sealants are designed for different movement capacities for different applications. So our movement happens between +10 to +100. So what happens? Some sealants have 10% movement capacities. Some sealants have 100% movement. So based on the nature of work, nature of applications, nature of abuse of the substrates, sealants has to be carefully selected. Now for this type of application, there won't be so much of variation in the temperatures and movements happening. So you need not go for a high movement accommodation sealant selection. You can go for a normal 10-15% sealant selection. That should be good enough. Where the movement accommodation of 10-15%, that should be good enough. But in case of pavements and roads, when you design the expansion joints, there it's a lot of movement happening due to the traffic movement, due to the open conditions, due to different climatic conditions all through the year. There, the, since the movements are very high, you need to select the sealant which has got a high movement accommodation. So we design sealants also with +100, -50 compression, that is +100% tension, -50% compression, and that can withstand, that can allow the designers to design expansion joints up to 100 mm wide also. So there are one or two projects I was visiting yesterday where the expansion joints are 100 mm wide and they want solution for that. So they are using silicone sealant for sealing the expansion joints 100 mm wide. So without any problem. Otherwise, what happens in organic sealants, if you select polysulfides or polyurethane, those sealants are limiting the expansion joint width up to 40 mm. You cannot use polyurethane polysulfide sealant beyond 40 because the movement accommodation is very limited, it's +25%. But silicon has been designed to withstand the movement up to +100. So you can go up to 100 mm wide joints without any modification of the joints.
Is there any relationship between the
I think most very good question, and it's good for me also to answer. When you design a joint with, especially for the expansion contraction joints, the designer has to take care of 2:1 ratio, normally for a linear joints, not for the 2:1 ratio. That is, depth is half the width, or other way, width is twice the depth, both sides. Okay. Now, that is for the linear, but not for the joints at the corners. So, what happens? Now, if you do a design of the joint in 2:1 ratio, now, if I talk of 100 mm joint, wide joints, that means you should go for a 50 mm wide deep sealant application. So, you can understand how painful it is, 100 mm wide joint and 50 mm deep groove to be filled with sealant. It's really painful job for any applicator. For a designer, it's very easy for us to put in the drawing board and the drawing sheet that put it 2:1 100 by 50 groove. But the person, engineer working at the site, cleaning operations, manning operations, then sealing operations, the applicator doing the job, it's really painful job. But This is happens for the organic sealant. When you design it, you have to go up to 2:1. But for this inorganic solution for silicon, the silicon, due to its inherent properties of inorganic technology, beyond 25 mm, you can limit the depth of the sealant to 12 mm. Up to 25 mm, you can maintain the ratio of 2:1. Beyond 25 mm, if you go, you can limit the depth up to 12 mm. So 100 by 12 mm should be good enough for you to seal the joint. So it's less painful for the engineer to execute the job at site with full quality control.
What distance of the area on this plant? Say the per unit area strength of silicon. Is there any bigger over there?
Absolutely. Every sealant and adhesive has got different mechanical properties. We measure in the terms of tensile strength, ultimate tensile strength, elongation, peel strength. So there are different adhesives. For structural adhesive, as we saw the building, that has got a different tensile strength. For this type of weather seals, especially for the expansion joints or the building sealant, these have got tensile different properties and different tensile strength. So all the mechanical properties are available in our data sheet. So when we discuss offline in terms of product selection, we can share with you all the technical information of what the tensile properties are. But certainly the best of the elongations happen. You can got an elongation up to plus 1000% also. That's the elastomeric components properties. And you can get up to a high tensile strength up to 0.2 MPa, up to 0.35 MPa even. And we have also got the adhesive with a 1.6 MPa also. So there are a lot of sealants, and based on the criteria we select the sealant, so everything is available.
What about the durability?
How should I say that?
Yeah, it is exposed to sunlight, in temperature, very temperature, how low it is.
Historically, the research and the proven solution, what we have done until now and what we have done. I said the first building, what we did, the structural adhesive as a glazing system, was done in 1971 in the Detroit. Okay, so the building is still performing to its best till now. In 1994, we did the first glazing system in Mumbai. That is a four-sided glazing. So that 1994 and 2015, it is almost 20 years. So that is the SR house, which has been done in Mumbai. So if any of you are visiting India or Mumbai, we can show you the building over there. The building is still performing without any problem. So the book says the silicon can withstand a durable life more than 20 years without any problem. It's having now, again, when you see an organic component, organic chemistry is the chemistry of carbon and oxygen bond. Silicon, as I said, is a chemistry of silicon and oxygen bond. Now, if you see the measure the bond strength of carbon oxygen and silicon oxygen bond strength is 452 kilojoules per mole. In the carbon oxygen, it is close to around 350 kilojoules. So here the bond strength is much higher than. So in terms of UV resistant properties, SiO bond is a much more durable UV resistant product in terms of durability.
What is the
bonding
capability of the silicon
bond?
I have seen sometimes it's very thick.
Correct.
So how you are going to get it?
That's a very good question, and I think we need to educate more to the, especially at the low end of the market as an engineer, how to educate them. As I said in between, that silicon is a very generic name. It comes in different chemistries. The first of the chemistry is the acidophilic cure. That is the most more generic and easily available in the market, and those are the cheapest solutions. So when people do use the acidophilic cure sealants, and that has got a negative bonding with the cementitious substrates. Because acidic cure means it is releasing acetic acid while the curing mechanism is on. Silicon is getting cured, it is releasing acetic acid, which is again a negative pH. While cementitious is an alkaline material, it has got a high pH. So So both cannot come together, both cannot marry together. So that is one of the reasons of debonding of sealants. Second reason of the sealants getting debonded is when you use sealants with an extensive fillers into the material. You have got silicon oil, basic low grade material, and people use fillers like calcium carbonates or something like that to make the product low cost solutions, and that is again a cause of debonding of the material. So you have to use the right selection of the product and right material by application. Third is, people are not taking care while applying the sealant. They have to clean the substrate, you have to rub the substrate. There should not be any deleterious materials, there should not be any problem. There should be proper gap, it should be properly tooled while applying. So those are the different application challenges where we need to educate the applicators for doing a proper good workmanship, and then it will not be a failure. So there are different, could be different possible reasons of failure, but it is not always that sealants fail. Because when we design a facade or a structural glazing system, as we said, we also do quality management system, protocols and quality management services we do provide. We give general warranties of 10 years for any structural glazing. So you can understand what type of risk we take in designing the building facades and delivering the building facade with full quality control measures, and where we talk of 10 years standard warranty. In certain building designs, customers have asked for 20 years warranty. Building warranty is 1 year. Normally, when we build a constructive building, the builders developers give 1 year warranty for the building. But I don't know, I think the most disadvantage for us is when you design a waterproofing system for the roofs, people ask for 10 years warranty. Building cracks, that's okay. But waterproofing should not crack for next 10 years. That's again a problem for us. So similarly, when we design a building facade, we don't know the building RCC column will perform for 20 years or not, or the plaster will perform or not. We don't know that. But the designers are asking, or the end user is asking us, 20 years warranty we want for the performance of your facade. We don't get that also. So in terms, so that's a technical challenge, but if we do a proper monitoring of those workmanship, as I said, that factory made glazing versus a site made glazing, there is a lot of differences, and we do promote customers, the engineers, to avoid the site made glazing. We always try to specify factory made glazing, so we can do a proper control of the workmanship, and the confidence of giving warranties becomes much more easier, and performance becomes robust. It's a difficult actually, you know. To my experience, whatever I have seen, you know, first is when you cut the sealant and the cartridges and all. One is you can always see whether any material is floating on the tip of the nozzle. That is, if you see a low grade sealant, mostly will see when you cut the nozzle, you will see that liquid floating on the substrate. That is the oils basically. Oil should not be seen on the substrate, because people are using a lot of oils in the sealant, it will start floating on the substrate. So what happens when you use that type of sealant as a low grade sealant in the application, you are using oil. And oil is a carrier. It's not a sealant, it's basically a carrier. So when you use the oil, oil evaporates with time. So if the normal curing time, as I said, 35 minutes as a tag free time and 7 days curing, you are evaporating the oil within 5 minutes, and what will happen? What happens to the cement when the cement hydrates faster? It cracks. So it's the same thing. Oil, when oil evaporates, the basic material will start shrinking, it will crack and it will debond. So that's the basic way of looking into. Then you can extrude the sealant. You will see a good quality sealant, the extrusion, it has got a standard extrusion rate in sealant. So that extrusion rate is either available in the data sheet, or you can ask the supplier to give the extrusion rate. If it is a very lean material or filled with lot of oil, the extrusion rate will be very higher. It will be 400 grams, 500 grams per minute. And if it is a thick viscous material, good quality material, it, the extrusion rate may not exceed more than 230 grams per minute. So there is an equipment to measure extrusion rate in lab. But at site, you can just squeeze it out, you can see slowly which is what is happening. So your the sealant is coming out and then deforming. So you can measure the deformation based on your technical expertise. And you can understand it's a good quality sealant or bad quality sealant. So those are small things, petty things, which I think you can do it yourself, you can learn here. And as you go, we can also educate and we can take a call after that. That's a very good question actually. That's the reason I said that we have got sealants of the different market application, different substrate. When I talk of the horizontal sealing, that is basically concrete, pavement, highways and all, plus building also, we have got expansion joint sealant, normal, which has got a low modulus. Now sealants come in different form modulus. One is ultra low modulus, low modulus, medium modulus, high modulus. Now high modulus sealant means the strain effects are very less. When the strain effects are very less, it's called a rigid material. Where do you need that? It's an adhesive, basically for the glass and the aluminum substrate for bonding the adhesive. But in concrete, it absorbs a lot of energy. So concrete has got a lot of expansion material, expensive material basically. So you need sealants to perform in its durable life cycle. So it should expand, it should contract. So you can select sealants which are low modulus, which are ultra low modulus, depending upon the designer's requirement, what exactly as a designer you would like to propose. Because you know the better expansion of the material when you design the, and how much gap you are keeping within the two expansion, two vertical members. So when you put a gap, so you have to design the gap based on the movement accommodation of the sealant you select. Now if you are selecting a sealant which is plus 100, minus 50, you can pretty well go up to larger joint size. If you are selecting a sealant with a medium modulus, with a lesser movement accommodation, then your joint size should not be more than the sealant expansion, otherwise sealant will fail. So it's the supplier and designer's technical discussions we do it before you design the panel, that how much joint size you should keep while you select the sealant. So that's again a technical challenge most of the designers need to keep while selecting a sealant. Otherwise, you may end up the wrong design and the wrong selection of the sealant. Because that movement accommodation plays a very bigger role in designing the joint width of the gaps on panels. But silicon as a material, it has got good bonding ability with the cement, with glass, with metal, aluminium, steel, stainless steel, wood. On the top of the substrate, it has got good bonding ability. It's basically silicon. The chemistry is different. I said that silicon is a basic material, but depending upon the requirement, you have to select the right product for the application. So you have to share the information what exactly your desired requirements are, and then we can propose the right products for your solution. So that, you know, ultimately it's a designer's perspective. It should meet the service life of the desired material, and the expectations of the end users should be met. So it's a communication between the designer and the supplier, what exactly is required, and we can propose you the right solution. I think we are running out of time, so I'll just run fast in terms of innovations. What we do, we are, as we study the mega trends, we also try to innovate. So one is, the first is a crystal clear bonding. I think there's a crystal clear bonding when we talk. I will just specify in short. You'll see a lot of idler fittings available in the glazing system, and normally the glasses are drilled with holes and the bolts are happening. So it's a spider fitting system. So what we have designed, a crystal clear silicon adhesive. Adhesive cannot be seen,
but the spider lumps from the back is added to the glass with an adhesive. So this is one of the innovations we have done, eliminating the drilling of the holes and the removal of the spider molds. So that's again innovations what we have done, which we call as a crystal clear bonding. So that's an innovation challenge we have done. Then smart structural glazing, as we said, that since the wind loads are getting high, the buildings are getting taller, lot of technical challenges come from the designer's perspective, architect's perspective. So we have got design solution elements for the designer to be proposed with a better engineering solution. Somebody requested, do we have technical properties mentioned? Yes. For this type of smart structural glazing, we have sealants and adhesive with a higher tensile strength, which can withstand those type of wind load pressure up to 7 kPa and all. So that's again an advancement we have done. Then design energy and efficiency, we have got building management systems, we have got designers who are taking care of this, and we do help with our customers to design a building with a building management system, with the design efficiency. Then the architecture insulation model. This is basically a blanket where the energy efficiency of the building needs to be gained and through different silicon blankets. So that's again a module we have. And that's how it is a smart type. That's again a repeat of this actually. I'll not talk much. In terms of silicon, again, what I'll just talk in brief. In some of the areas, glass needs to be coated with some color. So we have got glass coatings, which is a flowable sealant. Sealant in the flowable form. You can spray or you can brush apply on the glass and the spandrel area, especially for the building. So we have a flowable sealant which can be coated on the glass. So that's again help you in bringing opacity in the glass through this technology. Then some of the architects require colors on the glass. Adjust something not doesn't want to see black sealants or something like that. So we do provide colored sealants also. So sealants come in colored solutions also. And innovations coming forward is the smart glazing, because when we see a better management system, better lighting system, we talk of smart glazing, smart windows. And this is the liquid crystal being inherited or being induced in the silicon as a glass, the glass medium, where the glass can be transformed depending on the light you want to have within the building or outside the building. So if you don't want more of a light in the building, you don't require curtains. What you can do is you can do some induced liquid crystals into the silicon, and the glass will automatically turn opaque. And that's the technology what we have done, and we are now trying it and testing it in the USA. And if you need some sort of light coming in between, so the glass can be changed to different shades depending upon the opacity, and you can keep changing the shade, and it can be designed in different liquid crystal form, and that's why we are trying to develop this solution. I think this solution should be available by end of next year, commercially available in the world, and maybe early 2017. So this has been tested, and this is the latest of the technology of which we are trying to do, and that makes difference throughout the world from Dow Corning about innovative solutions, and that's the technology from us.
Are there any more questions you may ask? We can allow 5 minutes. The service like for the structural silicon type, you have to apply after a certain time. You have to apply it to make sure that.
I said that since 40 years we have done the first glazing, we have not changed it. But as we do, the standard warranty is of 10 years. So at least 10 years, your liability period is on us. After 10 years, what we can do is we can recheck the building with our technical team expertise, do some field testing, and revalidate the certification process for next duration of the years up to whatever the agreement is, and we can ensure that the building performs to the extended life also. So it's a mutual agreement, and we will be part of this design process also.
How is paintability?
Paintability is again lot of discussions are going on around the challenges is that we do had paintable sealants, but what we say saw that in the sealants move in a different form because its elastomeric properties are bit different.
people do ask as a paintable sealant. We can provide a paintable sealant, but paints do have a different movement accommodation. So two incompatible products coming together when joined hands, there will always be a fight who performs better. So what happens? Silicon will always perform better because it is designed for a different elastomeric expansion. But paints do not behave that way. So we can provide that, but ultimately at the end of certain number of years, maybe 6 months to 1 year or 2 years timeframe, we have seen that paint starts cracking from the edges and then start peeling off from the mid center. So does it satisfy the need of the architect or the consultant? That's the big question for us. Now, if tomorrow the consultant asks, I require paintable, we will start offering paintable. But we will not guarantee maybe. But you know, we as an engineer, we need to highlight this to our architects also, that with two different incompatible movement properties of two different materials, those two cannot join hands together. They will always clash. So depending upon the requirements, we can do. But silicon can be paintable. We have coatings also, water repellent coatings, which can be used on the plaster as a water repellent sealer, and you can use it on top of it an acrylic emulsion coat, which will have good bonding and it can be painted. So we do have that. So it's a question between the performance versus the requirement. What I'm getting on.
We have a color.
I said this is what color of facade. Not only the glass facade coloring, the edges of with a different color shape. We have got white, we have got brown, we have got here gray, light gray, black, different color shape. Apart from that, all weather seals, all the silicone that comes in standard color, different color. And if the project size is good enough and we can, more than batch, we do give custom colors also. It can be pigmented. That's not a very big issue. Very good question actually. Silicon has got very good stability in terms of UV, and that helps in pigmenting. When you pigment the sealant or any product with the silicon technology, especially for the darkest shade, it's stable. We have done research, we have done testing with a deep shade colors like brick red, terracotta red, and the dark blue, ultramarine blue. Silicons have remained stable, the silicon added colored pigments have remained stable after 5 years also under different conditions.
I think Saha, I'm comfortable with calling him Saha.
Absolutely.
I think he took us to a very interesting session. Thank you very much for your knowledge sharing, and I would like to invite the Mr. Gani to the
group. Very good. That was a good session for me and you all. Anyway, before going to the thank, I would like to invite again to our